There's a rumor going around the genealogy community that Ancestry ThruLines are equivalent to genealogical ThruLines. But they're not. Today, in this video, we're going to talk about why you need to proceed with caution when you're climbing your family tree using Ancestry DNA ThruLines. Howdy, I'm Devin Noel Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you learn how to climb your family tree, understand DNA, and preserve your memories along the way. This is another installment of videos about Ancestry DNA ThruLines. If you have missed any of our previous videos, be sure to check the descriptions for links to videos and a playlist. Let's understand where Ancestry ThruLines come from so that we can make better decisions as we come across them in our research. So once you have a DNA match, ThruLine kicks in. It looks for your link tree and the link tree to another match, and that those trees should be public or private searchable. And then the ThruLines will start looking at your tree for the information you have. Who are your parents? Who are your grandparents? Who are your great-grandparents? And all the way back. After the Ancestry ThruLines program has established your tree, then your tree will be compared to the tree of your matches. And then if there's any overlap, then Ancestry will tell you that you have a common ancestor and a common path between the two of you. If there's ever any gaps, then Ancestry will look at other people's tree who have the same or similar people as you do in your tree and try to bridge the gaps. Let's say this person is you, and let's say that this person over here is your DNA match. So in your tree, you have your parents, and then you go up your mom, and then you go to your mom's dad and your mom's mom, but then your mom's line takes you up to this set of parents, and then you come up to this ancestor who then has this person over here. And that's where your tree stops. Now, let's say your match has these parents, and then they go up through their mother and then to that mother and through that mother, and there is where their tree stops at that point. Well, what would happen if Ancestry looks at the two trees and says, these two people are the same. They have the same name. They have the same birth date. They have the same death date. They have the same locations where events are taking place. Perhaps they are the same person, and then Ancestry will combine your tree and create a through line. Your tree goes up, over, and gets to this ancestor, but then you can evaluate this tree over here to see if that DNA match that you share and the information on this tree is valid. And then you can then go add that to your tree. And when you do, instead of having dotted boxes, you will have solid boxes because you will have proven that match. But what if you don't have this person in your tree? Well, maybe, here's my tree. There's a third person's tree, and that person has this person and this person, which is really the same person, and have that person. Then what Ancestry does is looks at your matches tree, your tree, and the third tree that connects the two together. And then once again, you have a potential relationship tree, and that is an Ancestry ThruLine. Ancestry ThruLines have been nicknamed ThruLines, and the fact of the matter is they're not. They do take your DNA matches and your member tree and the member trees of those that you match an attempt to piece together a family tree, but that doesn't mean it's 100% accurate and the gospel truth. We need to understand a little bit about what genetic genealogy is. On this channel, Andy has talked often about genetic relationships. And one of the things he points out is that we are genetically related to only 120 of our ancestors. That takes us back to our fifth great grandparents. Additionally, it is extremely difficult to piece together your family tree when you're matching people with very small centimorgans. Are you confused yet? But the one thing I have come to understand is triangulation, at least in theory. So you know that you match someone genetically without question when if you are person A and you match somebody who's person B, let's say it's your aunt, and then you have a third person, person C, and you all match, not only you match your aunt and you match this other match, but that match matches your aunt and your aunt matches them back. And here's the most important part. You all match genetically in the same spot. But on Ancestry DNA, you cannot see how and where you are genetically related to someone. You can see that you match, let's say, person B, your aunt, and then you can see your matches. But what you can't see is if you're matching in the same spot. Unlike MyHeritage, Family Tree DNA, and 23andMe, you cannot see where your matches match each other. When you see those boxes around your chromosomes where this was A to B and this is A to C and together it's B to C and A and everybody in the triangle, that's when you know you match each other in the same spot, and therefore that's where you go up the same line. But Ancestry doesn't have that triangulation feature because they don't have a chromosome browser telling you exactly where you and your matches matches correlate. So when it comes to whether these through lines are true lines, you have to remember that when you're looking at your ancestry suggested through lines, the people down here are your genetic matches. Once you leave this area, you are now in the genealogical tree. And what that means is you are not working with DNA anymore. You're working with theories and hopefully sourced relationships. But it's not genetics after you leave that realm down at the bottom in green. So does that mean we should just discard the Ancestry ThruLines entirely? No. Do you discard records that are a little bit off completely? No. You just have to frame your perspective correctly so that you can climb your family tree and have the most success. I also hope that you will consider transferring your DNA test from Ancestry.com over to MyHeritage so you can take advantage of that chromosome browser. You can do that without taking another test and it's just a nominal fee. Or you can also transfer your DNA test over to GEDmatch. And Andy has a lot of videos that walk you through how to do just that and how to use the tools on that platform. So where's the problem? I'm glad you asked. The problem comes that once you leave the DNA and go into member trees, some trees have been validated with documentation, census records, vital records, land records, and the like, and other member trees have no sources at all. And it's entirely possible that some people just see a name and say, oh, that sounds great, and they add it to their tree without doing any of the genealogical research to back it up. However, sometimes those theories are accurate. And isn't it nice that ThruLines speed up the process of helping you come up with theories of how you and your DNA match relates without you always having to build the trees? So in essence, you have a starting point. You can see that you have a match over here, my match over here. It's a fifth cousin with 30 centimorgans in two segments. How might they be related? Well, I know that when I climb this tree and I come over here, all of that is based on research, genealogical research. I also know that this is somebody I need to evaluate, and if that's accurate, then I now know how I am related to not only my match, but people beyond just this fourth great aunt. So again, remember to proceed with caution. And Dana Leeds of the Leeds Methods Color Coding System for DNA Matches had this advice. You know you're looking at a weak through line, one that you need to be very suspicious of, when all of your matches descend from one line. So if me and this match from Mary Jane Townley, if we keep climbing up our tree and that's the only match we have, it could be weak. Could be. Remember, it could be. Additionally, your DNA matches have small centimorgans that you share. So in this case, I had 30 centimorgans, and that was a good match. But when you have 5 or 2 or 1, you might have a weak through line. Not always, but let it be a red flag that you need to investigate further. So what would be an example of a strong through line when you still need to validate with other records and genetic genealogy combination strategies, but one that, yeah, this is a good theory to investigate? Well, your matches come from multiple descendancy lines. Additionally, you have documentary evidence supporting these lines. And finally, most of your centimorgans are larger than about 10 centimorgans that you and your match share. So Ancestry ThruLines are a cool tool, one that we can use to help us process our matches. The only thing we need to stop doing is calling them ThruLines until we've done the research to validate the tree. So my question of the day is this: what question do you have about where do Ancestry ThruLines, the theories, come from, and if there's anything else we need to further explain? Now, with this understanding of why you need to proceed with caution with Ancestry ThruLines, I can't wait to share follow-up videos about how to use them. Thank you so much for watching this video. My name is Devin Noah Lee, and this is Family History Fanatics. Be sure to check out some of our other videos about genetic research and genealogy research.